even have to go anywhere because this is the Talk Beat Jones.
Hi, this is the Talk Beat Jones. I am Billy E. Jones and
Michelle Broughton.
And we're going to be enjoying Miss Michelle Broughton today. So you get ready because I've been telling you for almost a year that she's going to be back. And Miss Michelle Broughton will be here to give you her report, her thoughts, her feelings, and all of the great things that's going to come from Miss Michelle Broughton. She'll be able to give you her title, be able to give you her position, be able to give you her love, her thoughts, and her feelings. I do believe so that I am going to do what they say, disappear.
Don't disappear. Don't go too far. Welcome, welcome, and hello and salutations. This is the last week. Let's get right to it. Go out and vote. Vote, vote, vote. That's what we need to do, family. It is so important. The invisible people are trying to take away, once again, our privileges, our rights, and that cannot happen. We cannot lose the rights and the privileges that it took so hard to gain. So again, this is November. This is the month. This is the year. This is a time that we must go and do what? Vote. I am not going to tell you, although I'm a precinct delegate, who to vote for. But what I need most important is that you go and vote. Because so many times you'll hear it in the media and in the national media, we're discounted as minorities, as black people, African-American people, black women. They don't treasure our vote because they can't count our votes because they don't think we go and vote and we don't vote in a large enough number to matter. That's what they say. But if we go out and make a great showing, then their ears kind of tune up and we have the power to change many things. So if you value your freedoms, your privileges and the rights that you enjoy right now today, you go and vote. You take somebody to vote. You make sure that 18-year-old will also go out and vote because most importantly, anybody 18, 21, 30, it's really going to affect them. I am not 30, so I'm on the other side. It will damage our quality of life if we don't go and show up and show out and vote. We have to become active. We have to become in tune. Many people tell me, oh, I don't like politics. Oh, it doesn't work. My vote doesn't count. But guess what? If you got some mail in your house that normally shouldn't come in your house, they understand if you decide to go and vote, your vote counts. They do. Because I have mail that from the other people, all kind of other people that would never, never come to my house, but they understand the power of the vote. I'm talking about the Green Party. I'm talking about the U.S. Tax Party. And oh, yes, even the Republican Party. So just remember, your vote does count. And some people understand that. And that's the power. Sure, you can donate to campaigns, but guess what they need the most? They need your vote. They need your vote to be successful in order to put forth their plan. And if you're not included in their plan, then guess what? We are out. We are outside looking in once again. So that's one thing I just want to keep telling you. Please exercise your right. Go and vote. Now, on the other side, I am also working in the community for your city councilwoman at large, Mary Waters. We are going to be hosting a seniors event, and I believe it's the 17th. You can call our office at 313-628-2363. It's a senior day. It's for seniors. We want to celebrate you. We want to honor you, and it's a movie day out. And so if you like to participate, keep your ears open. I'm in the community. I have flyers, all of those kind of things. And we hope that if you're able, you can come and partake. Also, we are in the community trying to once again let our constituents know that if you are in need of tax help for your taxes on the house, to have some reprieve or maybe have a ability to get in a program to pay for your back taxes so you won't lose your house. You want to stay in your house. That is a property that you never want to lose. That's a pot of gold that we don't kind of appreciate. There's the HOPE program still taking people. You have to sign up. It's online, so that when you are in need of service, you would fill out that application, and it goes through a process, and then you may get services, and it might be just what you need to save your home. Also, if your income is a little bit like you're the working class, but you still need help, there's the My Half program. But you have to fill out the HOPE application in order to be channeled to the next programs. So just think about that. If you need help, ask, because help is out there. And what else is going on? Well, we just had the celebration of children being able to go out and enjoy and partake in the candy festival, which you all call Halloween. So far, so good. Detroit didn't burn the day before, so we're looking better. There is no longer that mayhem going on in the city. Why? Because we care about our city, we love our city, and we cherish where we are. Neighbors are working together, getting together, because we are valuable. The city is a pot of gold, and everybody else knows it, and we better get on that same train. Now, anybody that knows anything knows, I'm going back, that this is the time that we have to vote. So who's up for election? Your governor, your state reps, your state senators, your county commissioners, they're all up for voting. Voting. So do your research, do your homework, fact check it. If you get the ability to meet any of them, if they come and knock on your door, ask them the questions. And also ask them what type of resources are they bringing back in particular to your community. How are you going to be able to access any funds that's going to benefit your block club, your neighborhood, the city, the whichever part of the city that you live in? How are they going to make things greater and better for you, the taxpayer, you, the next door neighbor? You are their constituent. And if you didn't know, you are also their boss. They work for you. They are public servants. They are there to serve you as best as they can. They are there to make sure that the state, let's start there because the governor is up for re-election, bring the funding to Michigan. Bring the federal dollars to Michigan. State reps, bring the money to your districts. Please do. Please do. We have things that need to be addressed. And one thing in particular, and this is a state issue, health. Health, whether it's mental health, which is a big issue and underfunded, or regular health, just staying healthy, Michiganders staying healthy. We need somebody to be a champion to address with funding and programs mental health. Because every time there's a news story, it's because somebody was not able to get the medicine or the medical attention that they need. Somebody was lacking services, and it turned out really bad. So think about that. That's a big issue. That's the biggest issue. If we could get a mental health facility back in the state of Michigan and funding, our families would not suffer like they are currently, and everything could start healing, because we need healing in the city of Detroit. We need healing in the state of Michigan. So that's one thing I'd like to share with you, and that's a really, really big topic, the mental health situation. They throw it out there. They throw out the nuggets and the caveats, but nobody has a solution, or they're not sharing the solution. Nobody's even addressing it. They're just saying, that's the problem. But if you have family members who are unable to address whatever that mental issue is, and we have nowhere to turn to, we have no doctors to talk to, we have no programs to put our loved ones in the program so that they can stay healthy, so they can become healthy, then yes, somebody that cares about you or I needs to address the mental health deficiency in this state of Michigan. So I want you to think about that. I want you to think about that, because they bring it up a lot. I'm looking for solutions. I'm looking for the state to return services to that particular area, because it's always in the newspaper. Also, COVID hasn't gone away, so don't think it has. Stay protected. On top of COVID, we have the flu season. On top of the flu, there's something else that's new, and I don't want to call the letters wrong. It's three letters, RSV or something like that. It's an upper respiratory issue, and it can make you very sick. They say in infants and in the elderly. So we want to make sure we continue to wash our hands. If you're in public, you should mask up, because you don't want to catch the flu. And again, even if you get inoculated, that means if you get the flu shot, does not mean you won't get the flu. It only means that the flu won't kill you and you won't get it as bad. Because the flu, they don't talk about it. You can die from catching the flu too. But then all of a sudden we had COVID, and COVID is way more dangerous than the flu, but it all equals out to causing you to be very sick. And if you're not lucky, or if you're not having your boosters and up to date with the medications, then you might pass away. So just think about it. Nobody wants to talk about it, but I'm going to talk about it, because it's real. It's serious. Teachers are still getting sick. They don't talk about it because nobody wants to send the kids back home. And I'm not saying that. I'm saying that it's important to stay safe. It's important that things are clean, things are cleanly. It's important that you keep your hands washed and maybe have on a face mask to stay safe. Because at the end of the day, we all want to go home to our family, to our loved ones, to our puppies. We want to go back home. I do. So I'm just saying, stay safe. We have to think about it. If I don't talk about it, we don't think about it. Because everybody, we're getting into the other season. Thanksgiving is first. Remember that. Thanksgiving is first. Be thankful. Thankful that you made it one more year. And then after that, however you celebrate the end of the year, that's coming up. So I'm going to call it a holiday season, so I don't step on anybody's toes or forget a holiday that some other people celebrate that might have escaped my brain. But anyway, people are getting back together. They're having these large gatherings, and all I'm telling you is to be safe, because I want to see you back here, and I know you want to be back here. So let's go on another thing. We took constituents, we took a tour of the city, so I'm going to go back to being a city. And we learn quite a few things. Mr. Illich has quite a few projects going on. And if you didn't know, as a regular citizen, we have access to it. And as school-aged children, as they graduate, they might think about going to Wayne State to go to the Illich Business School. Why am I even mentioning that? Because they have scholarships. But if you don't know about it, you can't access it, and you might be the person, or you might know a person, or you might have a family member that really wants to get into business and they want to get a business degree, it's expensive. But if you go through Wayne State, and if you are lucky enough to apply and get into the Illich Business College, there's money. And after they have scholarship money and you're successful, guess what? They guarantee to place every graduate in a job. Now, of course, they didn't say you're going to make millions of dollars, but guess what? You get in on the ground floor. And I don't think too many colleges guarantee their graduates employment. So that's something to consider if you want to go into business. Just think about it. And the same thing, once you are trained, you get a job, or you become an entrepreneur, you have to know how to do your taxes, and you have to know how to run your business and keep your paperwork in order. Then let's go on the city side. You can apply to be a vendor to get these city contracts that are $1 million a pop or more. And so you might want to think about that. But you have to prepare yourself. You have to get ready. You have to be ready. That's the thing. You have to be ready. So you might want to learn some things. You got to look out. You got to listen out. And yeah, Illich and a couple of others own a lot of parcels in Detroit. But guess what? You have to make sure that you're a part of that. And as they allow people in those spaces, make sure we are those people in those spaces. And that's how we are able to benefit from their monopoly of owning companies and business in your city, in the city of Detroit. So just think about that, because don't let financial issues be a reason that you don't take part in the upper education in order to have that certificate or degree to do better and to go higher places. Don't let that be a barrier. Do not let that be a barrier. So with that being said, for those that want to be in skilled trades, the city is also hosting training, and you are going to be paid for your learning and your training. And skilled trades are looking for people, but guess what? You got to have the skill. You got to have the skill. And right now the complaint is we don't have enough people, black, brown, or indifferent, with the skills. You have to have math as a strong base when you're in skilled trades. You have to. So just think about it. If you don't like math, think about money, because we know you like money. We know you like money. So money and math go hand in hand. And that's something that we need to make sure that we have in our belt. That's another tool that if you have it, take you a long, long way. Take you a long way. So, what else? We have make sure this is also the time of the year where we need to look out for our neighbors, especially our elder neighbors, and just make sure that they're okay. Not that you are responsible, but we are, because we all are our brothers and sisters keepers, or we should be. And that's how you build a community. That's how you have a strong neighborhood. And back in the day, they used to call it nation building. And that's what you want to be about. Because if they're doing well, that means you're doing well. That means everyone is doing well. And we are doing well, we prosper. And that's what we want, right? We want to prosper. Think about it. Just think about it. If you're the only one that's doing well, then what happens? Just think about it. But if most people in your circle are doing well, that becomes something that you can build upon. Just think about it. Just think about it. And there's nothing wrong with celebrating us, because we need to celebrate us, and then everybody else will join in and also celebrate us. Us African-American urban neighborhoods, that's what I'm speaking to. We need to have the pride. We need to be proud. Like James Brown used to say, I'm black and I'm proud. Whatever it is you call and relate yourself to, just be proud. And in that way, people will respect you and things can start becoming better, way better. Just think about it. So we want to stay healthy, family. Oh, yeah, they are building this, I don't know what you call it, but they call it a walk greenway. You might want to join in. You know about the river walk, right? And that's a beautiful sight. We just need to take part. We need to take part. Everybody else enjoys it. And we need to do that too. That's a way that you can be healthy and enjoy the outside, because you need to go outdoors. You need to see what's happening. You need to look up and you need to look around, because Detroit is changing. Whether you are a part of it or not, Detroit is changing. Yes. Yes, it is. Just think about it. They're closing streets. They're creating streets. Buildings are going up. All kinds of things. Just need to take a note of that so you can be a part of it, or at least be aware of it, because we're here and we need to be in the know. That's what we need to do. Absolutely. Absolutely. And what else would we like to think about? And also, if you have any family in any of those areas that are having troubles, like wildfires, burning, that's because of the climate change. Hurricanes, we have hurricanes every season, but every season they are not as destructive as they are, displacing people, killing people, that kind of thing. But you kind of wonder. And in Nevada, their famous lake, Lake Mead, oh my God, is going from here all the way down, and they're finding all kind of things, ships, bodies, all kind of things that were buried and gone. So, but that comes climate change. Just think about it. It's not a word anymore. And when it comes to Michigan, then, oh my God, but it is, because our winters are not the same. Our summers are not the same. All I'm saying is pay attention. And then somebody out there can be the solution, but not if we aren't paying attention. Just think about it.
Wow. It is so wonderful to hear you flow. You know, it is just a wonderful, wonderful time today to have you, Miss Michelle Broughton, with having the team fully here, and family who have been watching the Talk Beat Jones. This is the team. This is the team. That's the partner. And, you know, Michelle, I think that during the second half, we have the attorney Odie Utterback here. And of course, he is a wonderful, great attorney, but also, he is a great artist.
Beautiful.
And so he has brought in his artwork. He has also some artifacts that he wants to talk about, and so that we can introduce him and the places that he may be able to be seen. And why should I even talk about it? Why don't we just bring him on the second half and let you and he. How about that, family? See, nobody knows exactly what's going to happen on Talk Beat Jones. We flow. We
yes,
flow. Would that be good
yes.
for you?
That would be wonderful.
How about that?
Wonderful.
And then I'll step out again, and we're going to take that commercial break and be back with the attorney, Odie Utterback, and the host, Miss, what's your name again?
Michelle Broughton.
You know, you thought I forgot about that phase. What's your name? But anyway, family, we'll be back with the Talk Be Jones. Remember that every Wednesday from 10 to 11 live on a Wednesday, we're live, and we have a repeat broadcast on a Sunday from 4 to 5. Tune in, tell your friends worldwide, Roku, Amazon, Apple. Ooh, and let me do this real quickly, real quickly. If not, the boss man, Tim, may get me. To watch the Billy Jones Show, go to YouTube.com, type in the search engine of YouTube, TV 33 On Demand, look for Billy Jones Show and date of show. Or tune in to the Billy Jones Show live, www.tv33.com, and watch the Billy Jones Show live. And with that, we're going to take the commercial break, and we'll be right back.
LaWanda.
This is RJ Watkins.
Coming to you to bring you some information about the number one detox in the nation, Lemon Burn. Lemon Burn helps to turn the fat into fit. It's for you, a happier, healthier you. Because you know healthy is the new beautiful. An all-natural way to improve your health. It promotes a healthy digestive system, attacks and reduces belly fat, as well as gives you energy. And to get yours today, call 313-868-6612.
Don't forget to exercise and eat right.
ready to put your podcast on iHeartRadio? Yes, your podcast on iHeartRadio. What about Alexa, Roku, Fire Stick, Apple TV, Android, or iPhone? Plus live TV streaming. Get your podcast seen and heard all over the world. Call 313-868-6612. Pre-recorded shows are accepted to be archived. This is a WHPR distribution platform. Download the app from the App Store. Go to WHPRTV.com. Channels available for lease 24/7 on Roku, Fire Stick, or Apple TV. Coming soon, subscription and pay-per-view.
Also,
block time is available. Get yours. Call 313-868-6612. That's 313-868-6612. Executive producer RJ Watkins. Program director Henry Tyler. 107.5 FM WGPR HD2. RadioWeCanSee.com.
Have you ever wanted your own TV show? Have you dreamed of showcasing your talent for the world to see? Well, now you can. Have your own TV show. You can have your own 30-minute show. Not only will you be seen in the Detroit area, but you can be viewed worldwide. For more information, call 313-868-6612. Visit our studios and receive a free TV interview to promote your business, church, or organization by appointment only.
You don't have to go anywhere because this is the Talk Beat Jones.
Hey, and we are back with attorney
Odie Yuddy back.
Nice to have you. Now, I need you to give us, we're going to be educated in some art. And this art is absolutely gorgeous. And I need you to give us some background.
Oh, will do. All right. So, Michelle, again, I'm Odie Yuddy back. I'm an attorney. I'm someone who was educated down in New Orleans at Dillard University. I had opportunity to light a lot of things that are not commonly available to a lot of black community, and that's the artist. And so she brought to our attention that we can be artists. We can manifest some of our thoughts and ideas on canvas, marble, wood, etc. So she brought to our attention a couple of names, Samela Lewis. She's like the first black woman who cataloged the great black artists of the 20th century and beyond. And what happens is those books, her research, established a lot of the black studies in art across the university, across the universe of education. So if you went to UCLA, they'll probably have her book. And then everybody would stair step and build on her research.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they also, we had a professor called Elizabeth Catlett. Mm-hmm. She was a Howard grad, and she was welcomed at Dillard University to teach. Now, she's world-renowned. She's right there with Pablo Picasso and Juan Miró and all those sort of individuals. We don't really necessarily know it in our black community because, what, we're paying our rent, we're paying our car notes. We really don't have this extra money to invest, so we think. Mm-hmm. So if you were to buy or bought some of these early black Harlem Renaissance artists or artists who worked at some of the HBCUs around the country, mm-hmm. you probably would have paid $200, $300. Now they're $35,000, $100,000. Some have even hung in the White House. Now, we have other black artists. Basquiat, his cost, $220 million.
Ooh.
So now you understand why I'm excited to be here. I'm glad I accepted the invitation again with Billy Jones.
Yes.
Because there are people who learn differently.
Right.
So I could read and write, no problem. But some people have to receive things vis-a-vis auditory.
Right.
Right?
Visual.
And some
visual
are visual.
Learners, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so I must have been a little bit of all the above. Right? So my dad was a doctor. He went to Dillard Law, so along with my mom. But he always thought he could have been a better student if he knew how to diagram and illustrate what was put before him,
mm-hmm.
to really ingrain it in his memory. Because to be a doctor or a professional, you have to exercise your memory.
Right. Like drawing a heart and all the valves that are inside, or a lung or the rib cage. My daughter's a doctor too.
Exactly.
So I know what you're talking about.
And so I didn't go that route. Mm-hmm. However, I never had a problem imagining things. Like when you were talking earlier in the day, I can see you working in the city councilwoman's office. I can see you going out to the sites and giving people pamphlets and different things and disseminating this information. Mm-hmm. So what do we get back to the art? You got diagrams in those pamphlets.
Right.
Somebody got paid to do that.
That's right.
So you're asking about, you know, a little bit about art and career. Well, Walt Disney made $1 billion off of it.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But so too the printers. You bring them an idea, they start putting these icons together, and next thing you know, you have a piece of memorabilia, and it'll trigger your memory to do something that you want to do.
And comic books are art, too.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
We're not even talking about comic books, because that serializes a one concept, one picture, one character, and moves it along. Not like a motion picture, but like a little novel. So over here, I have one of my pieces, and this is Martin Luther King being arrested by some Southern white police officers, right? Now, this is in a primitive fashion, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what it does is it communicates, just like a cave, cave paintings, just makes it really simple and direct. He is getting manhandled. He has a suit on, hat on, and they're treating him like a common thief.
Right.
And he's a minister. So what happens is, without me putting in too many words, you can glean from the picture something unfortunate is happening to this gentleman. And that is, unfortunately, the history of our forefathers not that long ago. Okay? So that's Martin Luther King and these officers who were hassled. And that's the government and a citizen. So that's how the relationship was at that time.
Right. And they look angry. The police do. And he looks like, oh, my God, why are you doing this to me?
Right. And so when I was at Dillard, one of my classmates was the daughter of O'Neill Moore. Now, you're talking about politics. He was the first elected black sheriff in Louisiana, and they murdered him.
Yes.
And I was with my classmate, and I didn't know she lost her father to a lynching, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And so it just impressed me that much more. You got to get out of this school with everything they can offer you. So I heard you talking about WC3. I graduated from Highland Park High School in 82.
Ooh.
My mom taught at the Highland Park Community College.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is not a one-time thing you do and you rescue your family from poverty. It's successive.
Mm-hmm. Over years.
It's over years, and it's not an overnight thing. You got to work on it.
Right.
So I have a picture here of three generations of Whitmores. They asked me, Miss Lisa Whitmore asked me to put all three of the matriarchs of the family on one picture. So one might be from 1927, one might be from the 50s, and then we have one picture from is contemporary.
Now, tell us what is the importance of the three women? Those are three generations.
This is three generations. And it kind of segues in what I was just saying. The most modern of the women on the your right, I guess your left on the screen.
Green?
Right, in the green.
Mm-hmm.
Her daughter just got two doctorates from Carnegie Mellon.
Ooh.
In science. Ooh. So we know once upon a time it was illegal to teach black people how to read. Mm-hmm. And then we fast forward within like a generation and a half, someone getting the highest, most difficult degrees offered in the United States and if not in the world.
And successful.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And so they thought it was good to commemorate all of this history and simplify it.
Mm.
Right?
Yes. Yes.
And these are, you know, again, these are black people who wouldn't say no. They're from the other side of the state. And we forget that there's blacks in Grand Rapids and Benton Harbor and Kalamazoo. And I hope they get to see this.
Flint.
Because Flint, Saginaw.
And when
we talk about HBCUs, historically black colleges and universities, sometimes they deliberately don't get the message.
Right.
They don't get the offer, hey, you can also try one of these schools.
Right.
Okay? Because HBCUs have law schools. Mm-hmm. One or two might have med schools.
Right.
And anything else you can imagine. And then we partner with the majority schools.
Right.
Okay, so when I was at Southern Law, I also went to LSU, Louisiana State University. So I saw those people. Now, these are my classmates from 1982 when we all started freshman year.
Oh, wow.
They all were in Detroit. Not all of them, but two are from Detroit and three from other places.
Mm-hmm.
And so people say, I can't find a job. Well, these people are not even from Detroit and have jobs in Detroit.
Wow.
You have to qualify. Mm-hmm. You have to prepare. Mm-hmm. And it's exciting, and it's not so much of a, what do you say? It's not a sacrifice like you think, but you must, like you were saying, you have to sit down.
Right.
You don't need a mansion. You don't need a Rolls Royce. You don't need any of these things. What you need is a chair, a light,
table.
Pen and paper, and table, and all of you sit down.
Mm-hmm.
See, East Indians in their culture, they have all members of the family drill the kids.
That's right.
On all the work every day.
That's right.
Now, absolutely. That puts them at an advantage. You're not at a disadvantage. They're just at an advantage.
Right.
You just got to decide to put in the work.
Absolutely.
And you can do it.
Right.
You got another one?
And the thing is, too, in our culture, like you said earlier, our parents had to work so hard just to live. That means to keep heat and lights on, to feed us more than just, you know, nothing. We had to have a protein. We had to have vegetables. I don't want to name and give anybody any, you know, props, but our parents worked so hard. But however, in some families, we had the grandparents that lived with us in the home, and they did read to us.
Right.
Now, why come forward? We didn't keep that culture. I don't know, but our grandparents loved us so much that they wanted to see us do better. So they did read to us, even though sometimes they didn't know themselves how important it was, but it really is. And I've traveled everywhere a lot, and I sent my kids traveling, and then I was able to get my grandson sponsored, and he went to Africa. And he saw, like you said, different cultures treated the children differently so that they could succeed. But the kids listen. Today, I don't know, and I'm an educator. I'm from education.
Sure.
I taught for 28 years.
Yes.
And it comes from the family, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
The family has to wrap around the people that they belong to and say, look, this is what's important.
Mm-hmm.
This is what's important, because guess what? Once you're educated, and I love Black colleges because they love you when you come to their campus and they make sure you graduate.
Mm-hmm.
They do that.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't lose this. Once you have it, you have it.
Right.
You can lose your Rolls Royce. Your house can burn down like you see in California. The mansions you saw in Florida, the people, their mansions gone. You're like, oh, my God, what to do? But now we're back to you.
Yeah, oh, hey, I was in seventh heaven. So they changed. Now, this is a picture of Frida. She was a great artist of Mexican descent. And people don't know that Mexico was free of slavery at some point. And the rich people of Louisiana, specifically New Orleans, funded the Texas Revolution to bring and expand slavery to the Mexican lands that we call Texas.
Ooh.
And so they have a thought about slavery that Black people still have. We still haven't shook the trauma. We're celebrating the Alamo, and the Alamo was to keep us enslaved.
That's right.
Okay, and so what I'm saying, so Frida was, you know, much after that, but her husband's murals are in the Detroit Institute of Arts.
Yeah.
Okay, Rivera. And what I liked about her is she was in accidents, she suffered from disease, abuse, and she kept on coming, and she taught herself how to paint while in the hospitals, emulating her husband. She never surrendered, and she was the icon of the woman's suffrage.
Right.
Okay, so that's something I did. Now, I'm self-taught. when I said I took a class at Dillard, that was it. However, in New Orleans, they have like 100 years of free black communities, 100 years older than ours in the rest of the United States.
Right.
I mean, you had pockets of free black people, but they had a considerable amount because they came from Haiti, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a lot of Jewish liberal slave owners, if you can imagine that. You could buy your freedom.
Mm-hmm.
So these people could buy freedom and then undertake the arts and go off to different schools, Scotland and different places.
Right.
And then they come back in France, and they come back and they had such a exacting will to educate.
Yes.
Now, you might not have it, a coat on your back, but you have a degree or at least know how to read and write.
Right.
Those ministers were a little different then because they looked at reading like Jewish people read. Looked at reading. They're 100% literate.
Right.
So you say, oh, well, let's compare ourselves. You can't.
You cannot.
We were fabulous with labor.
Mm-hmm.
The law said you couldn't teach us.
Right.
So we had to overcome that and get over the trauma of people saying, we're not going to fund your schools. You don't need to be at school. You need
right.
to be at work. You need to be in the fields. You're lazy.
Mm-hmm.
Just because we don't pay you anything doesn't mean you shouldn't work until you pass out.
Right.
So we're coming into literacy because we need to raise those numbers.
That's right.
Because we're only like 8-9% college educated.
Mm-hmm.
We also got to get into those vocations. They took the vocations out of the schools because they didn't want us competing with them.
Correct.
So, but vocations require, like you said earlier, mm-hmm. a deep understanding of mathematics, a deep understanding of design and illustration and different things to have it communicated not only to you, but to be able to translate it into action. So
right.
drugs and alcohol, you know, those are things that they want you to have. The party store is there, but the art store is not.
Right.
Okay, so I'm just saying, to be an artist is a privilege through all of mankind's time. Because you're supposed to be, you know, supposed to be at the grind. So not that art is without effort and work and dedication and diligence and resources, okay? So
right.
now what we got up now, well... Okay, so anyways, we got one getting ready to come up on in the queue right now.
Right, right. So what I'm going to say.
Yeah, go ahead, Michelle.
You're not formally taught, like, say, regular artists.
Right.
But how I would teach my students, there's a difference between a student and a scholar. Mm-hmm. You would be a scholar because scholars are self-taught.
Mm-hmm.
And scholars always strive for perfection and hunger for more knowledge, and they keep on. So yours is with the art, and you keep on till you perfect it. You keep on till you create something that's a message and meaningful for us, should be, when we see it, and that you're sharing it with the world, almost kind of telling a history.
Mm.
You know, so you are doing scholarly work.
Well, and listen, I've had a number of, you ready to switch over? Okay, so now, you said something about Africa, right?
Yes.
Well, I think of, if I asked you what was the name of the Americas before the discovery of Columbus, what would you call it, right?
Mm-hmm.
We call it pre-Columbus. We're still in the mindset of our oppressor at the time,
right?
And we don't know whether or not we were both African and people of this place. So you had the Mississippi Indians, the Illinois Indians, you had the Iroquois. What did they call this place before being confronted with people with hostilities of guns and diseases and alcohol?
Takeover.
So this is a throwback to an ancestor I don't know.
Mm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
This is a throwback to an ancestor who may have hunted, who may have planted crops, who may have saved the original pilgrims from disaster.
Mm-hmm.
Right? There's so many different stories. My sister worked on she worked for the nations, you know, Indian nations in Arizona, and she was a dentist.
Okay.
So she would go down into the Grand Canyon and deal with the different Indians at the bottom of the Grand Canyon. where you're forbidden to go.
Right, exactly.
Right? Mm-hmm. So these people have stories that you've never heard of.
Right.
You go up north, upper Michigan somewhere, you'll see other tribes there you don't know nothing about.
Right.
Canada, nothing about.
Right.
And so this is that kind of effigy of those persons.
Right.
That could be very well us, too.
Right. Our ancestors.
Our ancestors. Mm-hmm. All right. So we're going to transition into African art.
Mm-hmm.
This is something that we're going to make available at Debo's on Sunday.
And Debo's is located?
It's in Southfield, 12 Mile. It's on Northwestern Highway, just south of 12 Mile.
Okay.
And it's some guys, you know, some young brothers who got together and ponied up some investment and got it going. It's a franchise out of Memphis.
Okay.
So they have a delicious brunch on Sunday, and this is when we'll have that available.
Okay, so talk about
to the people. Right.
First piece.
So the first piece is a xylophone playing African persons. Now, I just want you to look at the muscles that go into moving those sticks where his foot. Just look at the balance of this piece. Now, you say, well, you didn't get educated to become an artist. I don't think this person was, but I think it's the innate decision to replicate what you see and experience.
Right.
Right? And so this would say to a young African-American male or female, you know, you don't have to have something electrified to make a sound.
Right.
You don't have to have Dr. Dre beats on to enjoy and experience music.
Right.
And so music and fine arts and the visual arts, they all run together.
They do.
They all run together. So this is some kind of wood, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I would say this is probably like a $600 piece, $500-something piece.
Easy.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
But it made its transition across the same ocean that a lot of us didn't.
Right.
Right? So it's here to remind you who you are.
Mm-hmm.
You're not Miss Eddie Bauer or Ralph Lauren Polo. This is who you are.
Right.
You're a creator, and you're not a consumer, which we're guilty of being here.
Right.
And I said, we're just non-producers because they don't want us producing.
Right.
Okay. So this is a production piece.
Okay. And
so
the second.
The next one. Now, obviously, these are from different tribes.
Yep.
Right. You can just look at their facial features and different things.
Mm-hmm.
We hear about families, mom, dad, daughter, son, uncle, auntie, but multiply that by 1,000, 2,000, right?
Mm-hmm.
We have a tribe. It's not the Johnsons or the Wilsons.
Right.
You got the Yorubas.
Right.
Right. You got the Igbos. You
right.
got the people from Benin. There's so many people that you have to leave the community to find somebody, you know.
Right.
You know,
right.
find somebody that you can mate with, et cetera.
Right.
So there's a whole nother idea of family that we just don't get. But anyways, that's a beautiful woman. And then again, another thing is we're not afraid. We've been taught to shame, to be body shamed.
Mm-hmm.
Buy clothes and hide your nakedness. Well, if you don't have these sick ideas of what the body is,
right?
You don't have to really be concerned about it.
Not at all.
You know what I mean? But some kind of way, we got this wicketry stuff in our head, and you know,
it was given to us.
We right.
Didn't think that way.
All right. So now we're going to move to a fold. Another one of my pictures. Okay. Now, this is King and Stokely Carmichael in my mind. Okay?
Ooh, yeah.
I met Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture, in New Orleans at Tulane University.
Tulane.
And he came not to give me handouts or anything or say, hey, look, you know, there's $1 million at the bottom of the aisle. I'm just going to share with you my experience.
Mm.
And it was immeasurable.
Yes.
To think that the government was coming after him and his friends for trying to improve his own community.
Right, our community.
You got
uplift
me?
Us.
Right.
And the young people. That's
right.
Who they're afraid of.
Now, Martin Luther King was the classmate of my college president. They were best friends, Dr. Cook.
Mm.
That was his best friend, right? Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is, this was not that long ago. I'm trying to tie some of this
right.
from their era to my era,
right?
When I drive it through Atlanta and see Andrew Young Highway and, you know, all these different superstar civil rights gentlemen
right.
How can it be such a dull topic here in Detroit with the young people?
Right.
They know how many kids Snoop Dogg has and all these different rappers.
All these people.
Yeah, and I'm like, these are the original rappers.
Yes.
They brought it.
That's right?
They shook nations. And so so I thought it would be beholden to make this.
Right. To share so that they can indulge and learn and have a thirst for this knowledge that they are lacking.
Right. Now, if you look at the other people, they're Caucasians.
Right.
And I love Caucasians just as much as I love black people. But in Mississippi, if they surround you,
you're in trouble.
You better have a thought about something.
That's right.
Okay. And there are those, like when you go to Mississippi, it's dark because they don't have, first of all, they only have like 3 to 6 million people in the whole state.
In the whole state.
And half of Mississippi is a national park.
Ooh. Okay.
Yeah. And so we're about to wrap it up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So we have one last piece to show.
Yeah.
And I believe it's a wood carving. And that's beautiful. That's beautiful.
So that's a man.
And a woman.
Woman. It's you have the antelope horns, and then you have the mask. Now, antelopes or cattle, that is a sign of wealth.
Right.
Then
exactly.
The union of a man and a woman is also a sign of not only unity, but power.
Right.
So
in the future. And so one more time, really quick, where can we find this?
Just this before
we
go? It's going to be at Debo's on Sunday during their brunch. And say 1 to 3. And you can, you know, purchase these items. We'll be there. I'll be there.
Is there a phone number?
You can use my number. 313-585-8694. 313-585-8694. And there's many more. I think there's upward of 20 pieces. But we'll have examples of them and some photographs because we can't bring all of them. Okay?
Wonderful, wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, I'm so glad you were here to share your
pleasure.
Knowledge with us and
yes.
your paintings and everything. And so I hope to have you back. And thank you and for enlightening us in Detroit. And we hope to see you soon. We are here. This is the Billy E. Jones Talk Beat Jones Show. And I appreciate you and family. Stay safe. And we'll see you soon. And Billy is seeing you sooner.
Have to go anywhere because this is the Talk Beat Jones. I'm better.